Hey, it's Don, the Auction Professor here. As promised, I'm going to answer some questions. I've picked some random questions from subscribers and viewers that have been left underneath some of the videos. So if you want your question answered, just leave them down below in the comment sections of the videos. And from there, we will randomly pick some out and answer them in another video. So we're going to do this every week or two, and we'll see how it goes. Now, the first question here is from Denim Labels, and they want to know if we work out of our house or do we have a warehouse. Now, the technical answer to that is yes, we do work out of our house, and we do have a place for storage. So it wouldn't be possible to have the amount of inventory we have unless we had a monstrous size house. So we do have a fairly decent size house, but again, we've got a lot of inventory, probably close to 500,000 items maybe at this time, not even including what's up right this very minute. So further goes on, I gather you sell mostly smalls, which is smart. We sell whatever we can get our hands on. I don't care too much on the size as long as it will go regular mail, or I can have UPS or Airborne FedEx pick it up. We do have accounts with all of the major shippers, and we have in many occasions driven big, large items to UPS or to a warehouse or to a trucking company on many, many times. So I'm not really concerned with the size. If it'll move really quickly, I don't mind letting it sit in the garage for a few days to make hundreds of dollars. So that should pretty much answer that for you there, Denim Labels. Next question is from Jennifer R., and she wants to know, do I utilize Amazon FBA for collectibles such as vinyl records, or do I merchant fulfill? I do not send in collectibles at all as FBA. I have heard of people that do that, but I have not done that as of yet. I just merchant fulfill them. I ship records out all the time anyway, so I've got a set pattern and way to ship them that's very, very easy for us. It just takes a matter of moments. I haven't seen any negative response from doing it that way. Nor do I think I'm losing much in sales, because I almost always have the buy box, depending on the type of records that I'm talking about, in records in general. Now, I have sent in other items in the collectibles field that way, but for the most part, I just don't do that at all. It's all merchant fulfilled. The next one here is from Kyle Perez. The question is, how do you get that gold for 20 bucks? And this refers to a video where I went to Estate Jewelers here in Toledo, and we talked to Ed, the owner of the company. I have a link right up here to that video. That gold was bought in big lots of things at an estate sale or a local live auction for the most part. When I go to local live auctions, in many cases, at the end of the day, there's just a bunch of junk in boxes or whatever the case may be, even junk jewelry, mixture of gold and such forth, gold colored. 99.9% of the stuff is not gold, but if you buy enough of it, eventually I do get a bunch of good gold that I can put together. I usually am able to sell the extra pieces that aren't gold as collectibles or for crafting and other things on eBay, and I still make a 10 or 20 times my profit on those sorts of items. Other gold I can find at estate sales for items that may not be marked gold, but then turn out that yes, they are. I've looked and bought gold for a very long time. And many times, even at Savers, we've been able to find some gold in the cases or even in bags on walls. Sometimes the earrings are gold or the earring backs are gold. Sometimes I've bought stuff like a whole lot of things at an estate sale, a box lot, and turned out to have some gold pieces in it. So all the gold that I got in that video literally cost around 20 bucks. I don't spend much on it at all. I'm not buying it usually for the gold. There's usually something else in there that will get me my money. The gold is just a bonus and extra thing. That gold took a little while to put together. It's not something that I just had in a one-time purchase. So that's another aspect of it. We save tiny little pieces like the backs of a earring post or something along that line. Little tiny charms, the ringlets, all of that kind of thing I save and just put together. We do the same thing for gold filled, because you can scrap gold filled. That's about like 8 carat, if I'm not mistaken, gold filled. Now, it does take a few months to get a big, large amount of, say, 5 or 6 ounces of gold filled, but at the end of the day, it's just brought in and scrapped as well. We still get some extra money out of it. Now, it's not as high, obviously, as, you know, 14 karat, 18 karat, or something like that, but it's still a real nice return on our investment there. So that's where the gold comes from, pretty much all of it. And the next question is from Stephanie Wilhelm, and she wants to know if I could do a video on how you pack and ship vinyl. I actually have a video out right now. Here is the image for it and the title of it. I will include a link right up here, and it shows how I pack pretty much all media items that we ship and sell. And the video will show you how to pack pretty much all types of records. It'll be 45, 78s, and LP 33s, sheet music, and other items as well, too. And the next question here is from Saul Amazuka. Hopefully I pronounced that right. When pricing on items, how do you not overprice? How do you not leave money on the table? Well, there's no 100% foolproof way to do that. Even if something, all the comps say something is worth only 10 bucks, sometimes you might be able to sell it for 100 bucks. It just depends on who is online at any given time. So I don't always worry about comp sales on many items here. I judge by what I think I can get out of an item. Many times I do price them much higher than they are worth. That also gives me leeway to take offers on those items. So let's say I price a $10 item at 30 bucks. Somebody comes in and offers me 10 bucks on it. I can shoot back 20 bucks. They come back at 15 and I sold it for 15 instead of just 10. Sometimes that $10 item I priced at 30 bucks will sell the first day it's up for that full $30 price, even though there's 10 or 15 of that exact same item that only sold for 10 or less. It's a perceived value on it. I have price things probably lower than I could have got out of them. But it just depends on how quickly I would like to sell them, what I have into the items. Have I already made money with other items I bought from that same lot? That is another case many times when I'm purchasing and doing that sort of thing. Just keep that in mind. It just depends on what you want to get out of them. Sometimes I will blow things out for less than I could get out of them just to get a quick sale. Or let's say somebody bought multiple items from me and I'll let them have other items that they're purchasing at the same time for a lower amount. But again, I can do this easily because I do price many of my items up higher than most other people do. Now, it's only in collectibles that I do that because you can get away with it in collectibles. There's no set market price, I should say, for most of the items that we sell. So sometimes it is pricing much higher than I think I can get for it. It doesn't really matter what it's worth. It matters what someone's willing to pay for it. Most people who buy vintage and collectibles don't look at what they sold for before. Some do, but a large chunk of them don't. And that's why you can price things higher than most other people do, because of that philosophy. So I don't usually underprice things. There's very, very rare occasions where I mix up and mess up something and I price it too low and it sold too quickly. Just because though something sells quickly does not mean that it was underpriced at all. So again, back to the other model, that $10 item I listed for $30, it could have sold immediately after listing it just because the very right person was online at that one given time. That's just how it works. You never know. There's no rhyme or reason, but many times we do price things higher and do sell it for a higher price. So that should hopefully answer that one. And the last question is from Brad Henry down here, and he wants to know if I can provide a little insight for what to look for when sourcing magazines and books. And he goes on to say, when I first began selling, I would buy any vinyl record and any and all hardcover books if they were cheap and pre-2000. Now he goes on, a shotgun approach he's taken that as, and he'd like to have like an in on it. The basis on anything that I purchase is that I look it all up. Before I would buy anything, including a lot of magazines or books, I would look through enough of the lot to know I would get a good return on my investment. Otherwise, I would not buy it, regardless of how cheap the items are. I look up every book that I buy, usually, even if it's a dollar book. Just don't want to waste my time. If I'm going to have to go home and look it up, I'd rather look it up while I am out, figure out if it's worth buying, and then go from there. There are some that I know always to buy for a dollar. There are quite a few, actually, because I've been doing this for quite some time. I'll give you one right here, The Talbot Odyssey. That's a book, no matter what, whenever you find an original first edition of that book, you would buy it. Look up who it's by. You'll be surprised. It's a very good book. Even some secondhands of those do sell very, very well. Book-wise, I look them all up if I do not know the book. Again, many times I'll run into books and I'll know exactly which ones to buy. We have many fine autographed editions, including some Stephen King and Anne Rice, that were bought by me or my wife at Savers or a Goodwill. So you never know what you're going to find, but again, I look them all up. I never make any purchase unless I know for sure that I will make some money on it. So I again, look it all up. Just be safe. be wise and look it up. There's no sweet spot that I could tell you, because you never know what you're going to run into or the value of any given book. On books even, an edition means a big deal. So if it's not a first edition on some books, it's just not worth buying at all. We try to stick to first editions as long as that's what's worth the money. Magazines, I only buy magazines, again, as I said, that are worth money. I know certain titles that I can always get money for and I will always buy every time I see them if it's a dollar or less. But again, it depends on the specific title of those magazines. Now, many magazines were printed by the millions, so even if you get them dirt cheap, they're just not worth much money. So look them all up. Know some titles if you're going to play in the book and the magazine category, and you'll do so much better than just randomly buying things. Again, look them up. With books, you can download an app that will store an entire database on your phone, so you can not even worry about having internet connection or Wi-Fi or phone signal to actually research books when you're out in the wild too. So you have to pay for it, but that option was there. That is something that we've used in the past when we scan books. But anyway, end of the question is, look every single thing up that you go to purchase if you don't know it already. Well, that's about it for today. If you'd like your questions answered, leave some questions down below on some of the videos, and I'll do my best to get to some just like this. I'll pull out a set number of them and we'll answer some and hopefully get your questions answered that way. Well, hopefully you enjoyed it. If you did, please hit that like button down below. You can also hit the bell icon to be notified if I post new content or go live. Subscribe and tell a friend.